I was asked if there were going to be any shenanigans today. And, you know, there's not that much of a gap for a Yeti to sit there, so I'm minimizing the impact, if you will. Well, it's good to be with you this morning. If you would go ahead and open up to the book of Colossians as we get started. I was asked this morning, Colin, I thoroughly enjoyed your sermon last week, challenged by the last few minutes that we have on this earth, what would we say? And it was so much so that I was asked, Brother Mark, are you going to have a timer this morning too? So I was like, no, I'm sorry. I'm not sure how that look of disappointment came at me, but you know, it's okay. As we get started this morning, I do have an announcement. The office just came into knowledge of this just a couple of days ago. We were notified that one of our former pastors, back when Towering Oaks was known as Second Baptist and in the original building, Omer Painter, passed away recently. And if anyone remembers him or knows the family, if they want more information, feel free to contact the church office. But we were contacted and asked to pass that information on to our church family. So last time I was up here back in November, we were seemingly kind of all over the place. Ezra, Nehemiah, several places in the New Testament, as God had laid on my heart to challenge us about personal revival. The revival that we don't want is what we have to face to see the revival that we dream of. That we want to see God move in the masses, but a lot of times we forget or we sit in wait because we don't want God to deal with us personally. But yet, when we want to see with revival, we've got to deal with God one-on-one and let Him examine us, let Him deal with us before anything with the masses, if you will, can take place. And then this past Wednesday night, I was teaching Bible study for Brother Tommy as he and Shelly are still out and resting and getting rejuvenated for this upcoming year. So continue to pray them. We look forward to Brother Tommy being back in the pulpit next week, Lord willing. But this past Wednesday night, we looked in Matthew chapter 9, verses 35 through 38, about Jesus' ministry, His example that He sets for us, what He calls us to, and where I believe we need to be looking at in 2024 of things that we need to keep in mind to focus on. Because in these brief verses, we see that Jesus was with the people, He was broken for the people, and He's calling us to pray for workers to go into the harvest. And we saw how the Greek word into means to go to a destination with a purpose, not to just happen to end up there. And so when we pray for others to go into the harvest, we pray and are praying that they hear God's voice, that they respond and go to the harvest, go to the field God has called them to with the purpose God has called them to, and they've heard and responded. And as we pray for others, we need to keep in mind that others are praying for us. And I find great encouragement in the voices this morning that have said, Mark, praying for you. That means a lot. And it's also something that we're commanded to do. Paul writes in several places in Ephesians and Colossians and the opening of Philippians where he calls us to pray for one another, to know God's voice, to know God's will, to know the glories of what Jesus is calling us to be in Him. And so as we're praying for God to send workers into the harvest, we have to keep in mind too that one of those workers going into the harvest would be ourselves because somebody's praying for us to be listening to God. And to sum it up, as I was praying about this morning and where God was leading the message and leading me personal this year. And consequently, you know, it's kind of neat. When I've got something on my mind, just in conversation with Jamie, my wife, the other day, she mentioned the same thing that's been on my heart. And so being more intentional this year, being more intentional in the Word. To use the action points from the sermon back in November, that we need to be willing and be intentional in the Word and Bible study. We need to be willing to be convicted, to be intentional in asking God to continually examine us, to be willing to be clean, intentional in our accountability, willing to live a life of worship, intentional in bringing honor to God, willing to live a transformed life, being intentional in living the desire of the Father, not living the desires of the world. And it's in the intentionality of discipleship that we often drop the ball, because I can say the phrase, we need to be intentional in prayer, and pretty much everyone in this room, everyone online, would have an idea, a pretty clear idea of what being intentional in prayer is. It would look different for everyone, but they would have an idea. More consistency, praying for others more, praying for God's will, lining up my want list with what God's want list is. Those kinds of things. I can say intentional, evangelism, intentional sharing, and that pretty much sums up what that means. Sharing the gospel, sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. But when I say the phrase intentional discipleship, it kind of varies, and there's a lot of different thoughts out there. There are a lot of different books. I probably own 6 or 7 different books on intentional discipleship or some variation of that phrase. And so I wanted to, and then felt led to dig in to Scripture about what that really looks like. And so we're in Colossians 1. We'll be starting at verse 24 in here in just a second, because we have to be intentional. We can't be haphazard. My family was intentional in a gift they gave me for Christmas just a couple of weeks ago. And I know this will shock no one who knows me, but I have this little issue of not knowing where I leave my Yeti. It's typically easy to find. It's teal color, and it's got a big old picture that says Fuge on it. There's another sticker that has deers on it. It's pretty easy to find, but I will invariably, at least a handful of times in the week, maybe in a day, misplace where it is, and I can't find it. So my family is very intentional that in the moment that I couldn't find my original Yeti, they bought me another one. My original is not misplaced. It's up in the cabinet in the pantry, for the record. Yes, Tori, I know where it is. But intentionality means we put heart and thought into it. It means that we are being personal, that I'm being intentional in this gift. My family was, it was a lot of fun, but they were intentional in the gift that they gave me, because they knew I sip ice water out of this thing on a regular basis. And they also know they don't want me in a coughing fit because of a dry throat. So, if you would stand with me as we get into Colossians 1, starting in verse 24. This is Paul writing to the church of Colossae. Now I rejoice in my sufferings for you, and I am completing in my flesh what is lacking in Christ's affliction for his body, that is the church. I have become its servant according to God's commission that was given to me for you to make the word of God fully known, the mystery hidden for ages and generations, but now revealed to his saints. God wanted to make known among the Gentiles the glorious wealth of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. We proclaim him, warning and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone mature in Christ. I labor for this, striving with his strength that works powerfully in me. Pray with me, please. Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for your word. We thank you for Paul's ministry. We thank you for the encouragement and the counsel he leaves. Father, as we dive into what discipleship looks like today, Father, I pray you open our hearts and our minds of what it means to long for you, to strive, to labor, what it means to encourage. Father, guide us this morning. May we leave today more in love with you than what we are in this moment. It's in your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. So what I'm hoping to do, if you haven't noticed it yet, is We're going to talk about some keys to discipleship. And for example, I have some keys. Now, these are not the actual keys to discipleship. These keys were handed to me earlier this morning that they were found out near the underground doors in the parking lot. So if you're missing keys, see me at the end of service. But we're going to pick these verses apart to see what Paul has to say, what God is saying through Paul. And the first thing, and you're going to notice, I'm going to like the words that start with I this morning. I'm just going to give you the heads up. These words are going to start with I. Verse 24, we look at the impact of discipleship. Discipleship's going to have an impact. Our growth in Christ, our growth on our journey, on our walk with Christ, is going to have an impact. Paul is an intelligent man. No one debates that. We see his resume in Philippians chapter 3, verses 3 through 6. He was taught under a rabbi named Gamaliel, who was one of the top rabbis of that day. So much so that Luke even talks about Gamaliel giving advice to the religious leaders on how to handle the apostles in the early chapters of Acts. And so Paul, he was known as Saul then, as his Hebrew name. He was the Hebrew of Hebrews. He was at the stoning of Stephen in Acts chapter 7. Acts 7, verse 58, they dragged him, Stephen, out of the city and began to stone him. And the witnesses laid their garments at the feet of a young man named Saul. Saul was there when he saw Stephen get confronted about blaspheming God. These charges that were trumped up because some people that were debating him weren't getting their way, weren't making any headway, and Stephen had an answer for everything and was proving them wrong, and they didn't like it. So they created a stir. Stephen preached. He preached the history of God's moving through the Hebrew people, culminating in Christ and his redemptive work. And Saul was there. He saw it. He heard it. We actually see that the first words of Acts chapter 8 are this: Saul agreed with putting him to death. And then Paul begins to persecute the church. Some translations say ravage the church. When you get into Acts chapter 9, Ananias says, isn't this the guy that's persecuting, killing, arresting, doing all these things to the church? He's persecuting believers. Paul had to have been impacted, I can only assume, because nothing is ever said, but I can only assume that in all of these travels that Paul had from Acts chapter 8 to Acts chapter 9 when he goes to Damascus, I can only imagine the impact of discipleship by the way disciples were reacting to being persecuted and arrested. I can only imagine that through their suffering, it had to have some sort of impact on Paul. And as Paul grew in his knowledge of Christ, because when you get into Acts chapter 9, Ananias is having this conversation with God in his prayer time, and God says, look, I've told Paul, this guy named Ananias is going to come and talk to him. And Ananias is like, oh, hold up, time out. You mean the guy that was arresting and killing and persecuting the church? And God goes, yep, that's him. I have plans. He's going to be my witness to the Gentiles, and he's going to know what he has to suffer in my name. So Ananias probably hadn't swallowed. Okay. And he went and he talked to Paul. Scales fell off of his eyes. And it says Paul spent some time with the disciples in Damascus. Paul was smart. He knew the Old Testament. He knew the prophecies. But it wasn't until the scales fell off and he saw Jesus face to face that he understood the prophecies and he understood the scriptures, because he spent time with the disciples in Damascus being taught. He immediately went and started teaching, and then immediately began to find out what suffering for Christ looked like. And now we get into this passage in Colossians, and he says, rejoice in my sufferings for you. And that is a theme, that is something that is repeated in the New Testament. Jesus even says it, Luke chapter 6, verse 22, blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you, insult you, slander your name as evil because of the Son of Man. Blessed are you when these things happen. Peter mentions it twice. 1 Peter 1, you rejoice in this, even though now for a short time, if necessary, you suffer grief in various trials, so that the proven character of your faith, more valuable than gold, is refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Chapter 4 of 1 Peter, instead rejoice as you share in the sufferings of Christ, so you may also rejoice with great joy when his glory is revealed. So we've got more than just Paul talking about sharing in the sufferings of Christ. James talks about it, consider it a great joy when you experience various trials. John writes in his letter, 1 John chapter 3, do not be surprised if the world hates you. And then one of the last things that Paul writes before he's killed in Rome, 2 Timothy, his last writing that we have, chapter 3, verse 12, Paul, wrapping things up, he says, in fact, all who want to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. So as followers of Christ, we can expect things to happen. We can expect suffering and persecution and trials. But the impact of discipleship is seen in how we handle that. When we go through those sufferings, those trials, those persecutions, how do we respond? How do we react? What is our body language? What are the words that come out of our mouth? What are our feelings when we are having our time with God? Now, I'll say this, and the book of Job shows it clearly. We can shake our fist at God and ask why. We can say, God, this isn't fair. I don't know why I'm going through this. I want an answer. What's going on? But we also see with Job, as we get towards the end of that book, you got to be ready for God's answer. Because Job responds and goes, I'm going to put my hand over my mouth. I don't have a clue what I'm talking about. I'm sorry. But how we respond in suffering and in persecution and in trials will have an impact on the people's lives around us. Again, I can't help but know or even have a high suspicion that how believers that Paul arrested reacted had an impact on him. It had to have. But not... Because when you look at history, the church grows when it's persecuted. And it's not just the church as a whole, but believers as individuals. When we go through tough times, our relationship with Christ deepens and gets stronger if we allow it. Sometimes we'll go through struggles and we want to tuck tail and run because I don't know of anybody that enjoys conflict. I don't. But we're called to work through it. We're called to increase our faith. We're called to have joy. We're called to endure. We're called to be the light, be salt. We grow through personal suffering, and then we pass on what God did in our lives to strengthen and encourage others. Paul writes this in 2 Corinthians 1. He, talking about God, comforts us in all our affliction so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any kind of affliction through the comfort we ourselves receive from God. For just as the sufferings of Christ overflow to us, so also through Christ our comfort overflows. If we are afflicted, it's for your comfort and salvation. If we're comforted, it is for your comfort, which produces in you patient endurance of the same sufferings that we suffer. Let's think about it. We go through a tough time, and then God shows up, and he does something. He provides something. He provides a healing. He provides a conversation. Whatever the situation is, we go to our family. We go to our friends. Maybe we come on Sunday morning. We're in our small group, or we walk in here, and we find the people that are closest to us, and what are we doing? You'll never guess what God did for me this week. This is what I was going through. I was asking God to take care of it, and he did something I didn't even think of because he did this. I learned so much about God. That is a growth testimony. So many times when we think of sharing our testimony, we want to talk about our life before Christ, what our life was, what was happening in our life when we came to know Christ, and what our life has been after that. But we also have a growth testimony. I was facing this. God showed up and did this. I've learned this about God, and I love him all the more because of it. And we can share that at work with those that don't believe. We can share that with others to encourage believers or to share of God's goodness to those who still need to know of the love of Christ. That is the impact of discipleship. That is the impact of us growing and walking daily with God, is that when we face struggles, we have the proper perspective. We know where to go. We know how to find wisdom. We know how to find encouragement. And we know that we have these close 2, 3, 4, 5 people in our circle that we know are going to pray for us, and we can go to for counsel. And then the comfort that God gives us, we share with others. Trials and suffering produces intentional prayer. Intentional prayer impacts the disciple because it's our communication with God. And now the intentional disciple intentionally shares what God has done. Or maybe worded simpler, trials produce growth. Growth encourages sharing. We are being intentional in our growth. We're being intentional in sharing. And we're being intentional in communicating with God. God, I know if you did this for me, I know I have a friend that's going through something similar. Move in her life like you did in mine. Give him, give her the opportunity to share of your goodness like you did with me, because I got to share your goodness with someone else. Now, I do want to take just a quick moment to talk about what this verse does not say. Because verse 24 is one of those highly debated verses because of Paul's choice of words. Paul writes, I am completing in my flesh what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for his body, that is, the church. What Paul is not saying is that Jesus' sacrifice was not enough and that Paul was completing it. No. Paul is not saying he's completing Jesus' atoning sacrifice. The whole of Colossians, the rest of the New Testament, is very clear that Jesus' sacrifice and resurrection completely covers the redemptive work of God's plan, that only through Christ do we have a relationship with God. What Paul is saying is, I am going through sufferings so that Christ's church can grow and people can hear about Christ. That's what he's saying. Paul realized that his suffering brought him closer to Jesus, which was good for the church. Because there's a close association between suffering and the relationship that Jesus has with his church. Paul writes in Philippians chapter 3, verse 10, my goal is to know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death. The impact of Paul's life is seen because we're here. God called Paul to take the gospel to the Gentiles. We are here because he answered that call and he suffered the things that he did for the sake of Christ. Because Paul had a willingness, 1 Corinthians 9, the end of verse 22 into verse 23, I have become all things to all people, so that I may be by every possible means save some. Now I do all this because of the gospel, so that I may share in the blessings. The impact of his discipleship is felt years, centuries later. The way our relationship with Christ is going to have an impact for years after us. It'll impact our family and our friends. It'll impact our coworkers, our classmates, our small group. It'll impact the people we bump into at Walmart or Ingles or wherever else we end up at. Our discipleship will be seen by those when we get the wrong order. We asked for no onions, and guess what? They found the strongest ones available and said, here you go. Our discipleship will be made known in that moment. The impact of discipleship challenges and changes our perspective on life's trials. Paul found trials a reason to celebrate. He found it as a celebration. It changed his perspective. Now we move to verses 25 through 27. This is the invitation of discipleship. Now, worship team, don't get antsy. I'm not wrapping up. I'm just using the word. Talk about no shenanigans. All of a sudden, my screen went blank. Anyway, as we grow, we begin to hear God's voice more clearly, and we begin to hear Him inviting us to the into the harvest. And our harvest field is going to look different. The harvest field is not necessarily, though it can include going somewhere overseas, out of country, to another state. But going into the harvest also includes going to work, going to buy groceries, going to get gas, going to get the oil changed. God is looking for workers to go into the harvest. He is inviting us to join Him. Also echoes the words of God in Isaiah 6. When Isaiah writes, I heard a voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? Who will go for us? And I said, here I am, send me. Or maybe in today's language, ooh, pick me, pick me. But the thing I love about Isaiah is that you got to back up a couple of verses. Before Isaiah responded, he was cleaned. He was purified. Because he realized who he was before a holy God and says, woe is me, I'm a man of unclean lips. And a cherubim came down with it, grabbed a piece of coal, touched it to his lips, and says, you're now clean. And then he answered God's call. This stems back to the sermon in November. Have we let God examine us for where we are before Him to be cleaned so that we can hear His voice of where He's calling us to go and what He's calling us to do? That's one of the invitations of discipleship. God's call and invitation on Paul's life was very clear. He even told somebody else, Paul is going to go to the Gentiles, and you need to go to Paul, as he told Ananias. The amazing power of the gospel is how it brings together people from all different walks, all different backgrounds, and brings them together. Paul writes in Galatians 3, there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free. There is no male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ's, then you are Abraham's offering, heirs according to the promise. And then you have John's words in Revelation 7, verses 9 and 10. After this I looked, and there was a vast multitude from every nation, tribe, people, and language, which no one could number, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb. That is the hope of eternity, is Christ in us. And the hope of Christ in us is the same hope that anybody everywhere who is living and breathing has, that same invitation calling out to them that God calls us to share. No matter where they're from, who they are, what they look like, God has called us to go into the harvest field to share the gospel with everyone. And that, again, is the amazing power of the gospel, is that it brings everyone together. That's making the word fully known. And that phrase is not just meant for pastors. That phrase is meant for every believer. Remember the Great Commission in Matthew 28. Jesus says, go into the world teaching and baptizing. He didn't put any other parameters that only those called can do that. We are all called to share and to teach and to disciple. This is an invitation for all believers to go into the harvest, to share the mystery of the gospel, which is that it's available to both Jews and to Gentiles, which pretty much sums up anybody who is a human being. Now, one of the major invitations today is for the person that doesn't have a relationship with Christ. And I don't know if there's someone sitting in here that doesn't know or has been asking questions or is not really sure what happens after they die or if they would spend eternity with God or if there's anyone online. But I want to walk through and tell you that there's an invitation today for you to have the assurance of eternity, the hope of Christ in you. And I can give it to you in one word. We've all heard the word gospel, G-O-S-P-E-L. It means good news. You line those up, write it vertically, G-O-S-P-E-L. You can share the gospel by using the word gospel. Because when you see in Genesis chapter 1 and 2, you find out that God created us to be with Him. But Genesis chapter 3 tells us that our sin separated us from God. You read the rest of the Old Testament, Genesis 4 through Malachi 4, where we see that our sins cannot be removed by good deeds. We cannot be good enough. We cannot make enough sacrifices to be saved. And God doesn't grade on the curve. We see Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and that paying the price for sin, Jesus died and rose again. The sin in our life that separates us from a holy God, the sin in our life that makes us an enemy with God, because Paul writes in Romans chapters 5 and 6 that we are at war with God because in Christ we have peace. Before we know Christ, we are an enemy of God, but when we come to know Christ, we have peace and we are an heir of heaven. The Gospel of John shows us that everyone who trusts in Him alone has eternal life. And then Acts through Revelation, life with Jesus starts now and lasts forever. Our salvation happens in a moment, but then our discipleship happens the rest of our life as we look to the final graduation of eternity with God. And that's sharing the gospel by using the word gospel that goes from Genesis 1 to the end of Revelation. And that is the invitation that sits before us all. Do we know Christ? Do we have that moment in our life where we say, Jesus, I can't do it anymore. My sin has separated me from You. I need You as my Savior and my Lord, and I'm giving up everything to follow You. Now, it doesn't have to be those exact words. There's no guide in here in the book of, you know, Second Opinion that says you have to pray this prayer. The only thing that we know is that Paul writes in Romans 10, verses 9 and 10, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. One believes with the heart, resulting in righteousness. One confesses with the mouth, resulting in salvation. That's what we do know. You say Jesus is Lord, you believe it with all your heart, and you give your life to Him, and you tell somebody, Jesus will save you. That's what Paul writes. But then we have a second invitation. And the second invitation is to draw near to God. The second invitation is to hear His voice clearer. James writes, draw near to God, and He will draw near to you. This is the invitation to begin growing intentionally, not just haphazardly. To be more intentional in prayer, in discipling, in being discipled. Because discipleship is active. It is not passive. And so the second part that we're about to look at in verses 28 through 29 is for the believer. I'm just going to go ahead and lay it out right there. It is for the believer. Those of us who claim Christ as Lord, as Christ as Savior, this part is for us because it specifically talks about discipleship. But until we're a follower of Christ, we won't completely understand this. That's why we've got to have that first invitation to begin that relationship with Christ. And then we can answer the second invitation. Jesus calls us to make disciples, teaching them to obey. And these verbs in the Greek are active. It's not that, well, I did this on one day and I'm done. As you are going, teach. As you are going, disciple. As you are going, baptize. It's a thing that's it's in motion. It's active. And so we look at, here's another I word for you, immersive discipleship. We are called to immerse our lives with others. Matthew 9, Jesus was with the people. We all need a Paul that's pouring into us. We all need a Timothy of someone that we're pouring into. There are four things about immersive discipleship I want to point out, and then I'm going to kind of break those down and explain them. But here's the big picture, the bird's eye view. Discipleship is an active impression. We see the words proclaiming and warning. It's an active impression. It creates an active investment that's teaching. It leaves an active influence being presented mature in Christ. And it requires an active intensity. We see the words labor and striving. As much as I enjoy reading and teaching out of the CSB, the Christian Standard Bible, that's what I'm preaching out of this morning, I have seen on rare occasions, it's not perfect, but it misses the mark, I think, in how they translated verse 28. Because Paul is emphatic about the mission of immersive discipleship. Because the CSB, again, there's nothing wrong with this. I just think they missed. They translate it, we proclaim him, warning and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone mature in Christ. Paul's writing in this moment is a little more emphatic. You get to a more literal translation like New American Standard or the English Standard or New King James, you'll find, I'm going to read the English Standard Version. But here's what you find. Paul writes, him we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone with all wisdom that we may present everyone mature in Christ. Paul is emphatic that we are to disciple everyone who says they are a believer in Christ. He says it three times. I'm not a Greek scholar by any stretch of the imagination. I barely know how to pronounce euro, okay? But we have some wonderful free tools that we can dig into seeing the Greek. And in the Greek, it has it, the word everyone or every man, to get very literal, three times. The Hebrew doesn't have superlatives, you know, holy, holy, or holiest. The writers say holy, holy, holy. My understanding of Greek, the limited, is much of the same way. Paul emphasizes everyone is to hear the gospel, be warned about sin, and be taught the scripture so that everyone may be presented to God mature in Christ. Paul is actively impressing the urgency of the gospel. Proclaim and warning everyone, teaching everyone, so that we can present everyone. Paul even writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 2, today is the day of salvation. There is an urgency. Because James also says, we're not promised tomorrow. So discipleship is for everyone. We are all called to grow. Hebrews 13, warns us about not growing. Galatians 6 has encouragement to grow. We have the passage out of the Psalms, taste and see that the Lord is good. Peter uses that to say, some of you are still on milk when you should be eating steak. We are all called to grow, and that is the growth comes when we immerse ourselves with the lives of others. Proclaiming the gospel, we grow when we share. We grow when we warn, because we're told in 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17 that the word is sharper than a two-edged sword. That's Hebrews, I'm sorry. That scripture is breathed for reproof and correction. The Hebrews passage gives the same idea too. That we are to hold each other accountable lovingly, gently. We are to help one another, to warn about the consequences of sin. We are to actively invest in the lives of others. That's what teaching is. Teaching is actively investing. It's not just necessarily passing on information. It's investing a life so that my life is transformed and their life is transformed, so that 6 months from now we can look back and go, I'm closer to God because of what this person has invested in me. Paul tells Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 2, what you've heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, commit to faithful men who'll be able to teach others also. Then we have Psalm 78, 1 through 4. My people, hear my instruction. Listen to the words from my mouth. I will declare wise sayings. I will speak mysteries from the past. Three things we have heard and known, and that our ancestors have passed down to us. We will not hide them from their children, but will tell a future generation the praiseworthy acts of the Lord, his might, and the wondrous works he has performed. We need to invest ourselves in the lives of others, encouraging parents to pass on what God has done to their children so that their children can pass it on to their children for generations. We are to equip each other. We are to leave an active influence. We see that in Timothy's life. Paul even says, I'm reminded of your faith that first dwelt in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice. Timothy's mom and grandmother passed their faith in the things of God down to Timothy, and Timothy was one of the most influential young pastors of the New Testament church. Psalm 145 gives us the same encouragement. The Lord is great and is highly praised. His greatness is unsearchable. One generation will declare your works to the next and will proclaim your mighty acts. I will speak of your splendor and glorious majesty and your wondrous works. They will proclaim the power of your awe-inspiring acts, and I will declare your greatness. They will give a testimony of your goodness and will joyfully sing of your righteousness. Are we sharing? Are we investing? Are we leading our small groups to be leaders who are chomping at the bit to invest in others? Are we looking for some of our closest friends to say, hey, I'd love to meet once a week, twice a month, once a month. Let's read through the Bible. Let's get together and talk about the things of God and encourage one another so that we can grow. I would like to pour into you, and I want you to pour into me. Are we immersing ourselves in discipling, in growing, so that we can share? And then we see verse 29, I labor for this, striving with his strength that works powerfully in me. The Greek word for labor means that you work yourself to exhaustion. One example given, and as I was reading, is about the pastor D.L. Moody. It is recorded that he worked so hard that one of his prayers at bedtime was, Lord, I'm tired, amen. Are we laboring for others to be mature in Christ? Are we working to exhaustion to see others be who God has called them to be? Are we striving to be who God has called us to be? And then the word struggle is actually a stronger word than the word used for laboring or toil. The word for struggle is the root for our word agony, where we agonize over, in the Greek, it's an athletic event or a fight. We're agonizing, we're working, we're striving, we're giving it everything that we've got to see the goal met. And Paul says his goal is that so that we may present everyone mature in Christ. Paul was intense in his urgency for the gospel. So when it comes to discipleship, we see that there is an impact. People are watching. People take note of how we handle the struggles and the trials that come our way. When it's the good times, when it's the joys, when it's the celebrations, that's easy. But when it's the tough times, the way we act gets people's attention. There's an invitation to discipleship. There's the invitation to come to know Christ and have your eternity assured forever with Him. And then there's the invitation to continue growing. Our salvation happens in a moment. Discipleship happens the rest of our life. Spiritually, we need to grow just like we grow physically, mentally, intellectually, emotionally. We are to grow spiritually. And then discipleship is immersive, with an active impression, an active investment, an active influence, and requiring an active intensity. Discipleship is hard, but it's amazing when you see God working. And it's humbling when you know He's working in you. When you can look back and go, God, I see where I was and I see where You've brought me this. Let's keep going. Now, over the next week or two, there were going to be some tools coming out that are to help. To help with getting together with those two, three, four people. To help with sharing Christ. To help being more intentional in prayer. There are some tools coming out that we'll be sharing over the next week or two. But I wanted to lay the groundwork on what intentional discipleship looks like and the invitation that God has before us. And so we come to our time of decision. And the decision is twofold, or the invitation is twofold. Number one, do you know that you have your eternity assured with Christ? Do you know that Jesus is your Lord and your Savior? Do you know that heaven is your eternity? Do you know Him? That is the invitation. If you have questions about that, I'm going to be down front here in just a moment. We're going to stand and sing shortly. You can come down front and just say, or Greg will be available as well. Anybody that's near you could answer the question that you trust. And just say, I don't know what it means to follow Christ. What does it look like? What does it mean that He forgives me for everything from my past and my present, and He'll forgive me in the future? What does all of this mean? Ask. There's no question to be ashamed of. Just come ask. We'd love to talk with you and pray with you. And the second invitation is for you to deal with God and God to deal with you, to begin that intentional discipleship or to renew it. Maybe you've fallen off. Maybe you've just kind of slacked off. Man, my walk sometimes is like the swings at Dollywood. Man, it's nice and smooth going in circles. I'm having a good time. Other times it's like that teacup ride my children suckered me into when they were young. It looked smooth until it spun. Some of you are remembering that headache that those things give. But you know what? God will steady us. We come and we humble ourselves to Him. We bow at His throne and we say, God, I want to know You and Your mysteries. I want to know You and love You. I want to know everything about You. Point me in the right direction. That's what these invitations are. So as we stand and our worship team will come up, again, I just want to do a quick review. We can stand. It's okay. I know we're Baptists. We can stand. Baptist is a first time, a relationship with Christ. You have questions, come on down. Colin will be down front too if you want to talk to him. Second invitation is that to growth. Come deal with God by yourself up here. Come deal with God by yourself at the chair. Have someone to pray with. If you've been praying about a church home, if you need to follow the Lord in baptism, whatever those decisions are, invitation won't go long. I'm not going to beg, but I'm going to let the Spirit move. This is the time to come. Let's pray, and then our team will lead. Father, we thank you for this morning. Father, we know your invitation is twofold, to know you and to follow you. And Father, I pray that this morning, if there's anyone in the sound of my voice that doesn't know you as Savior, that they wouldn't hesitate, that they would take that first step and just come on and just be open to ask questions and for us to talk to and pray with. Father, that your Spirit would move. Father, for where we've come up short in walking with you, Father, forgive us, lift us up, pull us out of that miry clay, as the psalmist writes. Father, deal with us as only you can. We love you. It's in your name. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Amazing love, now flowing down from hands and feet.